When your boy Daryl Morey makes this inappropriate tweet in response to your suggestion that you might make a video, I guess you have to stop everything and deliver on that promise. Unfortunately, the game was instructive and frankly just insane enough that it took more than a fortnight, if I'm still allowed to say that, before they TM'd the term, to actually deliver on this promise, analyze the game fully, and bring you what you're about to watch here. So LC0, known as the chess queen as Leela, makes a fry out of the fish formerly known as stock yet again at the Computer Chess Championship, and this is the game. In this position, she played the move d5 because apparently having a great center and maybe a slight edge heading into the middle game wasn't good enough. She had to defy theory and prove everybody that the Renaissance is back by sacrificing a bishop on b5 before move 10. This is an exciting game. You're going to love it. We're going to back up. Leave no stone unturned. I promise. Going to show all the analysis. Even though it is in my blog, I'm going to make sure it's all revealed to you here without leaving any critical moments behind. Here we go. So we had e4, e5, typical stuff with the Ruy Lopez. Bishop to c5 is in the archangelesque landscape, archangel, if you want to call it that. It's the more aggressive development of the dark square bishop rather than more traditional stuff with either a Berlin or with a6. But after bishop to c5, c3 is played with the immediate intention of expanding in the center, which is why the main move, bishop to b6, was responded. Now, after d4, castles is also a move that Leela chose not to go for. The move e takes d4 is played. Now, this is not the most common move for black that Stockfish chooses. And I analyzed just so that one, always like to leaving everybody with a little bit of opening knowledge. And it's just something that I built in myself as a muscle when I was still an aspiring professional chess player. So I can't go over these games without asking, was this line forced? Was it the best line? What are the alternatives, right? What is really going on here on a structural level? And knight f6 is actually the main move here, I learned. There's several responses, but one of the things to show is that white is not actually winning the e5 pawn in numerous lines because e4 falls. So things like d takes e5 right away are met by the move knight takes e4. And after castles, even things like queen d5 don't really cause any dysfunction. The knight comes to c5, it can head to e6. Black is totally fine. After knight f6, there's also the move bishop takes c6 so that you can capture on e5 naturally with the knight. In these positions, black is not looking to take right away because of potential queen e2s, but actually just castle. And the compensation is very real here for black. After bishop g5, you even have the move queen e8. And this is a really fun line for anyone wanting to improve their Ruy Lopez or Spanish theory, because after captures, the main line for white is not to move the knight and actually give up the e4 pawn, but actually play queen g4 and then head for a perpetual check. So that's a fun little line to note. Yet again, after knight f6, the main move is castles, though. And after the move castles by black, bishop g5, h6, d6 is also a move. We get variations like this that just once again I wanted to highlight show that the e5 pawn is not falling without the e4 pawn coming right back. So again, the opening theory here is actually kind of important because what it does is it sets the tone with why did these engines play this line, right? Why are they not playing the main line? The point is there isn't really a lot coming to either black or white in the main line, and both of these engines are looking to get a fight. So e takes d4 is played, and that helps set the tone because when you get into these sharp variations, you want to know why they chose it. Why is it that Leela's playing a novelty that sacrifices a piece on move 7/8, and none of us have seen it before? Well, they're looking for fighting chess. They're not playing the knight f6 line, and that's what I was trying to show with that opening analysis. After the move knight cd7, you might think, why is this the move? Well, the main point is that once white has established this great center, you can't really sit around and ask it to poke your knights back. Knight c7 is actually the best move here. If you try to challenge the move d5 by playing d5 yourself, white will actually castle, and the e-file is opening too quickly. Things like d takes e4 actually lose even more than you bargain for, because d5 is not just a trade of knight for knight. White is actually winning material at the end of these lines because of the discoveries, or if you take, there's a fork on c6 between the king and the rook. So that's not an option. If you play the move knight to e7, instead of playing d takes e4, then we take on d5. If you take with the knight, the rook comes to the e-file with check. If you take with the queen, the knight develops with tempo. So white's initiative is very real and almost a 1.5 advantage if you analyze it with the engine. So there isn't really any other option. Knight cd7 is the main move that had been played. And after the move castles c6, every game previously to this had featured either the bishop retreating to a4, bishop retreating to c4, or the bishop even coming back to e2. All of those moves make sense, right? White has a center to protect. There's no reason to overexpand here and not be just a little bit better. But again, the renaissance is back. The move d5 is played here. When this game was sent to me by our director of content, Sam Copeland, he's like, "Hey, Danny, I think I might have found a game that's worthy of you reviewing here. A little bit of a game of the day video. You up for it?" And I literally was, right? I was like, "Kids, go play outside. Daddy's got to do some work, right? This is absolutely nuts." So c takes b5 is played because what else are you going to do? Taking on d5, again, white takes back, and you're just talking about a huge advantage. d6 is coming with the pawn being pinned. There's no way to stop it. The rook's coming to the e-file. The attack would almost be as dangerous as it was in the game. So c takes b5 makes sense, and here comes d6. Now, again, I really analyzed this, and as I said, buckle up. If you haven't paused the video yet, you need that snack. Are you watching this in the morning? You need that coffee? Pause the video now and go get it, because I don't care how long this video goes. We are going to analyze and learn something from one of the greatest chess games of all time. And I'm going to show you all the different options, because as a human professional chess player, semi, right? I'm not a grandmaster, but hey, I play one on TV. The point is, my brain wants to make sure that this actually worked. How is this a thing that has never been played before? How is this possible? And one of the things you do as a human being is you instantly ask yourself, well, did black have to be greedy? Because one thing the computers do is when they're up a piece, they're going to move the knight to safety. Okay, that's what Stockfish is going to do. My brain goes, well, was this really that good if black just gives back the piece, for example? So we start with this move. The problem with this is that after takes e7, queen takes e5, the knight has no place really to go. The knight moves and the queen comes to d5. And the point is that not only has white won back material in lines like this, but the initiative can't stop, won't stop. Knight to c5 is met by knight to c3, threatening knight takes b5, followed by something nasty, so a6 is played. And then now the move bishop e3 comes. And the more you let the engine think, you can use that max analysis at chess.com/analysis. Black is just losing large amounts of material. b4 is on the agenda, and there's almost nothing you can do about it. The bishop is a problem. The bishop can't move anywhere because the knight's a problem. And white is just dominating. So that's not a thing that can happen. So then I ask, well, okay, did the knight have to go to the safety square that Stockfish shows? What if it moves to a different safety square, let's say g6? Well, here comes knight to c3 again. And one of the main things we're going to learn about this sacrifice and why it works, why it's justified, is that it doesn't even have to be a checkmate right away. Because as you look at black's pieces and the whole idea behind the sacrifice that this d-pawn is running to create the dysfunction, white is doing the things that Morphy told us to do years ago, right? Justifying material, dogmatic point evaluations for the initiative, for squares, for opportunities. And it's absolutely fantastic to watch. Knight to f6 is met by e5, and when the knight moves again, bishop to g5 comes in. You're going to see in the game that black made extra efforts by moving the king early to give the queen a square known as e8 to avoid things like this. Because after f6 and all these lines, white is taking and the initiative is getting out of control. The other move, instead of knight to c3, is actually e5 right away, which is perhaps even stronger. And it's a really fun idea I wanted to show, because this is relevant to the game. When you play e5 right away, you're stopping the development, right? So what that says is, well, if you're going to stop my development, maybe black should slow down white. And this is a main move that Stockfish, even at depth 20, is recommending. But now a3 is played. And the idea is, well, what's going on with that? Well, I'm going to take here and then get my knight out. So let's say that black takes it. You play the move b4. The point is that a5 is met in many ways by b5 in a lot of lines by white, just keeping everything still completely trapped. The threat here is to just develop anyway with knight c3, knight d5. And again, it's a long-term initiative where knight c3, knight d5, bishop g5, rook e1, queen coming out. These moves are happening against the king and queen's will of the black army, and black doesn't have enough pieces that are joining the game to fight against it. I analyzed one line with a5, you play rook takes a3 first because the pawn is pinned. You don't need to play the move b5. And after rook a7, bishop g5. The initiative is just as crazy here with f6 and captures. Bishop to e3, rook e1 check is also possible. But bishop to e3, followed by the idea of doubling rooks quickly and bringing the knight to c7, is not only going to be winning the queen, but probably delivering checkmate in a lot of lines. So again, it's a fascinating idea when you see chess principles, the things we always love and like to think we adhere to, but as chess players, let's be often, most of the time we're too afraid to make these types of long-term sacrifices and give up the idea of being materially greedy over playing for an initiative that we sort of just have to believe in. But Leela believes in it, so now I'm a believer too. And again, a move like b4 doesn't slow it down. So this is a game that is predicated on the piece sacrifice made early. So if you're watching this and you're like, hey, like, this is too much analysis, get to the meat. No. Dikembe Mutombo, this is the meat. We just saw a piece sacrifice on move 8 that is not supposed to happen. It's not supposed to be on the board, but it is on the board. And hey, we're here. That's happening. So we have to figure this out and try to justify it to our brain. And again, so I'm looking at the position now. I'm like, well, there's no other way to save the knight. Giving it back doesn't seem to make sense, so let's go with what Stockfish did. Well, here comes e5. Again, we're slowing down development, and the immediate threat of bishop to g5 is what a lot of this sacrifice is predicated on. So black plays the move king f8. Once again, I already showed this idea of b4, but because I promised you I would give you every stone not unturned, I think I said that right, with b4. Bishop g5, now the queen is trapped, so you have to play f6. This is why you played king f8, right? You played king f8 to free the square e8, so the bishop to g5 would not allow the lady to be trapped, and therefore things like bishop g5 didn't have to be met by f6. So let's say you stop my development with b4 instead of king f8, now you have to play f6. Here's how that doesn't work. Takes, knight takes f6, rook e1 check, and after the king moves to f8, we have a3 yet again. This is the same idea, which is just mind-blowing to me. Shows how strong the initiative is. How often can you sacrifice a piece and then justify the fact that you're not going to settle on the square d2 for your knight? You want c3 because it heads to d5 and b5, where things get really nasty up in these squares. So you can afford a move like this. a3, b takes, b4 yet again. The idea is I want to bring my knight to c3. I want the rook to be able to capture here. And the pawns are not relevant at this point. Need more proof? I'll show you. Knight takes b4, knight to c3. Black is up a piece and a whole lot of pawns. But the threats here are, they are numerous. Some of the most clear ones are actually queen to b3 and knight e5. This is a very common thing that you're going to see happen in a lot of variations. If you don't do anything in this position, there's moves like knight to e4 coming, taking here, and the bishop goes to h6 with check with queen b3. There's just so much to do here with white is dominating based on the lack of development of these pieces. So h6 is a main move. Let's try to force and trade pieces. Bishop takes, and then rook takes a3 opens up another reason why we played b4 rather than taking back on a3 with a pawn. We want these access points on the king side. a5, queen to b1. This is a fun move because the main point is that after the queen comes to b1, queen takes b6, and knight b5, your queen is actually infiltrating over here to the king side light squares. Queen f6, knight f to d4 has a threat known as rook f3. And there's actually no way to stop it. Black is totally lost. Moving the king to g8 shows another reason why the queen is on b1, because we have rook e8 check and the queen guards this particular square. So some other variations, but again, I feel like I've lived up to my, I'm showing you every stone without unturned to show you a way this could end is after takes, there's no way to deal with the rook. So you take, but here comes rook f3 check and rook e8 mate. And of course, if you play queen f6, I just win the queen, and then queen g6 is followed by rook e8 mate on the next move. So again, I'm showing a lot of variations here because the whole point of what we're trying to prove to ourselves is that a sacrifice of a piece on move 8 was not something that only Leela can do. We can do it too as mere mortals here in this game that we love. So after king f8, knight to c3, queen e8 was played. Again, there was no point in playing bishop g5 anymore because the king had already freed this square, so let's develop. The queen goes to e8 voluntarily. We put the rook on e1. Now, h6 was played. I'm going to show the other potentially critical moves. Don't worry, the end of this video is going to go fast because guess what? It's winning for Leela. Hashtag twist ending, white's crushing. Because Leela's amazing. Anyway, love my hat, by the way. I know you want one. I don't even know if they're even for sale, so I'm not going to do like one of those shout-outs. I'm going to go to the merch store. I really don't even care if you buy chess.com merch. I don't even think these are available. They're kind of special and cool, but if you do, maybe they're... I don't even know. You can see for yourself. Look it up. All right, rook e1 is played. So h6 was played. Why was h6 played? Well, not only does it slow down bishop to g5, but it also stops knight to g5. In a lot of variations, this is an attacking move too. So what we're going to see, though, is that White's ideas here are now having been, they've been served and proven many times. The lack of development here means that as this position gets going, the initiative is going to be too much for Black. But the other idea that I think is super deep about the sacrifice, if we go back to just the fact that d5 was played to give up the bishop, and then d6 was played, Leela knew that Stockfish wasn't going to give up the knight, right? I had to analyze it from my brain, but let's say Leela knew this, right? Leela's gone deeper. So where's the long-term compensation? It's okay, it's based on the lack of development. We've talked about that. But also the dark squares that are being controlled. And as we got into the later game, I started to really understand how strong the threat of getting rid of this bishop was. If this dark square bishop falls, not only do these squares become access points for the knights, but also the dark squares for the bishop, both here and everywhere else, open up. And so what I want to show are a couple lines that, let's say don't try to stop that, right? Let's say, on the one hand, I've got h6. Well, let's say bishop d8 is played, right? Let's say we try to get that bishop out of danger and keep it, right? Just to show you how crazy strong the idea of getting rid of the dark square bishops is. Here, white plays bishop g5, voluntarily trading pieces just to get rid of that piece, with the main point being that once it's gone, the threat of coming into c7 is an absolute monster. The knight finds safety. Doesn't matter how you deal with this pawn now. Let me take it or defend it with something like b4. The knight comes into d5, and the threat of knight c7 is at this point forking the queen and rook. But even if it's just going here to force the queen to d8, and white continues to bring forward just natural attacking moves, the position is too much for black. The knight is coming to f4. We have so many threats here. This knight can't get developed, by the way, without losing itself. The position is overwhelming. If that bishop disappears, we have serious problems. So part of the reason h6 was played was for the purpose of being able to bring the bishop to d8 without bishop g5 happening. That's what Stockfish did in the game. So knight to d5 comes. The bishop goes to d8. Now there's no bishop g5. But the move b4 is played. And now with locking up this side of the board, you're making it even harder to develop. There are two main ways to try to fix this problem. One is the move that was played in the game, a6. We're going to get to Stockfish's choice. I had to analyze the natural thing I would want to do as a human being here. I can't get this guy out, can't get this guy out, can't get the queen out, can't get these guys out. But if I could somehow get the bishop here, I'd be developing. So b6 is a move. Problem with b6 is the move a4, which is going to help us understand why Stockfish played a6 himself. B takes a4, b5. And when the knight moves to a5, the rook takes a4. Give this position, just give it a little bit of depth, and you're going to see that we are announcing crushing ideas all over the map. White's pieces are coming to life, and black is just completely lost. The other fun thing is that the idea that was actually played in the game, knight f6, is already possible right away. This is something I am going to say you have to check out the blog about, because it's not necessary to go too into it. I think this version of things is better for Stockfish. Bishop takes f6, and it's not as easy for white to open up the squares that LC0 got in the game. But even already, knight f6 is possible as far as the next crazy move. Sorry, twist ending showed you the ending there, foreshadowed it. But a6 was played by Stockfish in lieu of the fact that a4 is coming. That was really the reason. a6, however, unfortunately, weakens the b6 square. So after the move bishop e3, threatening to come in here and get rid of this dark square bishop so that we can open up business on the c7 square, black plays h5 to try to fix the problem of lack of development on the king side. Here comes bishop to b6 to try to get these pieces off the board, as promised. And black is not interested in the business that involves trading here, mainly because, as we said, even if there's not other moves, which there are here, bringing the queen up, getting the rooks involved, a4 is actually still a move, even coming back to head to c7, this position is too much for black. So instead, Stockfish sees the opportunity to play knight takes b4, thinking, well, if you take here, now I get rid of your knight before you get access to my c7 square. So what was the point of going out of your way to get rid of my dark square bishop? And if you take here, I get the dark square bishop, and I get to keep it forever. You'll never get access to these particular dark squares. Everyone's happy. Seems like this is everything that Stockfish should need to hold and put Leela's latest dubious peace sacrifice to rest. But she says, no, this isn't dubious. If I run up against a wall, I just sacrifice more, buddy. Knight f6. Now I'm down two pieces. In fact, after takes, I'm going to lose a third piece, but you have to part with your queen. Queen takes e1 is played. By the way, this is all forced, right? The move knight f6 If you move the queen, bishop takes d8 is just absolutely crushing. The dark squares are still going to fall apart on takes with the rook opening up, and the mating net is real. Taking with the knight also opens my e-file and doesn't even win a piece. So taking with the pawn makes the most sense. After takes, you get the rook. Black in this position already has multiple pieces for the queen. Okay, if we do the math, it's actually a rook and I think two pieces currently on the board. But the problem is that a rook and two pieces, when half of them aren't playing and you're dealing with a king weakness, is maybe not enough. Again, we talk about this a lot. The initiative, the ability to create threats is what governs the game ultimately. The point values were put there as a guide, right? You still have to get behind the car and make the turns, even if Google Maps is like, turn left on 68th Street. And you're like, there is no left on 68th Street, Siri, because that's a one way, right? You still have to make the decisions when you're behind the car. The point is that the material points are a guide, and Leela is showing us that you still got to avoid the pothole or take that creative route that's not on that Google Maps, right, to get to your favorite noodle shop. I could go for some pho right now. What do you guys think? But the idea here is that White's initiative is based on the king's inability to ever find safety. That's really the thing. And as long as you can keep your opponent off balance and it becomes a what I like to call a split board game, the queen will always be someone who can flex over the pieces, because the queen is a one-man wrecking crew, one-lady wrecking crew, while the pieces have to coordinate to outplay the queen. So forget about the points and how the computers continue to evaluate it like Stockfish, and it still thinks it's better for a very long time here. Go ahead, look into it. But it's the split board and the weak king that allows the queen to flex in these positions. And the math is less important than the initiative and the actual threats. And it's simply fascinating. So if bishop takes b6 was played, the move queen takes b4, followed by rook to e1. Now the queen and rook are going to get too frisky too fast. The queen comes to f4, there's knight g5, there's rook e7. You're still not playing without the rook and bishop. It's over, just trust me. If you play knight to c2, which some people are looking at here, queen a5 is played. You can't take both the rook and defend your bishop at once, mainly because if you take here with tempo, the queen takes, and there's a threat of checkmate on d8, so you can't actually take a1. So, bishop takes f6 is played. Queen takes b4. This move is a move that truly, highlights or illustrates, proves the thing I was just talking about. It's about the initiative and your ability to make threats, not about the point values. If it was, you would save the rook over the knight. But queen takes b4, giving up the rook is a no-brainer, because you can't afford to move the rook and let this knight come back where it defends everything and your attack will stop, right? If the attack subsides, black will eventually create ways to develop. So giving up this knight to keep the threats is exactly what the doctor ordered, and Leela is in, right? The doctor is in. She knows what she's doing. So this is actually the position I spent a lot more time on, and it's the one moment where I feel like strongly, again, I'm not qualified. I already highlighted the idea that Leela has split the board. I think the sacrifice is fantastic. And by no means am I about to show a line that I think Stockfish was going to be winning in. But something about the way Stockfish approached the position to me felt a little off here, despite everything I said, that there had to be some goal to liquidate the threats rather than leave the knight on the board. Stockfish played h4, and I spent a lot of time looking at the move bishop f6 to try to trade. Okay, queen to c5 is the natural response to defend the knight and maybe slide over. Here, if black plays the move a5 to try to use the split board himself, threatening things here, trying to bluff at the idea of getting the rook out, even though you know you can't do so just yet, it calls into question what the next move is for Leela. If you play queen takes b5, the rook can come to a6. The queen comes back to c4, now we take g5, queen c8, king g7. Even in this line, where white wins back a bunch of the material, black still has the rook and a couple pieces for the queen. Yes, the a5 pawn will fall, and this pawn is certainly strong. And I think that Leela's the one playing for the win. But it felt like the coordination of the pieces here, giving back some of the material, was something Stockfish didn't want to do. Because if the pieces are coming out, maybe they can coordinate and play against the queen. The knight, by the way, on f6 also guards d7, which is critical. So I start to look at these positions as the king can guard the bishop guards the knight guards the pawn, the bishop will guard the pawn here, the rook will be here, protected by the knight. And it feels like this is the coordination that Stockfish lacked. I know it's a line that White's winning back a lot of the material. But that was one idea I had. The other idea was bishop f6 and then bishop takes g5, trying to trade here. This line looks a little better for White. Lila highlights, I actually analyzed this myself. After h4, rook e6, the fact is the rook is still very at bay here, so you can even take. And taking d6 allows bishop c5. This move is still not as fast as the other line. I really feel like a5 was kind of the key of that other line I showed instead of bishop takes g5. I actually think this is better for White, despite the two rooks and the material, than the other line I showed where the pieces coordinate. Probably Lila is still pushing. The queen can move. Harry the h-pawn is a real wizard. We'll see what happens. But bishop f6 to me felt like the more challenging thing to do, especially in the line that I spent a lot of time on. I really did use that max analysis thing at chess.com where it taps into like our depth 30 on the server. You can use it. And I let it think for quite some time. So again, bishop f6 followed by the move a5 using both sides of the board. I feel like that was maybe the key. But h4 was the move played. And the move queen to b3. Oh my gosh, she's so nasty. I forgot about that move. The pawn hits f7, forces the move knight h6, and now you go to d1. Again, the tempi that she is gaining while re-coordinating to create new threats is the thing that's so scary. Bishop goes back to g7, and again, the queen goes to e2, threatening e7. If you had gone to f6 instead of g7, the bishop goes to d4. And in this position, after things like queen takes, there's actually no way to deal with the fact that the queen has these threats. Queen f6 is a threat, hitting everything. I analyzed a couple lines. Let's see. If rook g8, you play knight h7, followed by the knight. Okay, this is just a mate line. If you don't, knight h7 just mate in 3 because it's check. I forgot the queen actually guards g7. So rook g8 loses right away. If king g8, I analyzed the move knight e4, and the knight comes into f6, also totally winning. So just to show the end of the line, knight comes to d5, f3 just simply frees the back rank, and you can't deal with things like queen f6 and knight e7. So it's an amazing initiative. I analyzed it. I proved it out. I promise. Lila's awesome. My mind's blown. Yada, yada, yada. Yeah, finish the game, Dan. So bishop g7 instead of bishop f6, again, because I just showed bishop f6 is met by bishop to d4. Bishop g7, now you get queen e2 at tempo. Bishop f6, the knight comes back to e4, now with a new tempo. Bishop moves to safety again. Queen gains another tempo, bishop g7, and now queen e3, which, believe it or not, is also a tempo because there's a weird threat here. Bishop to d8, followed by bishop to e7, check. And the fact that the queen is coming to g5 and knight f6 check is following, the king is going to end up getting mated over here on g8. It's freaking crazy, I know. Which means, like, if a move like a5 is played, which is a move I kept trying to analyze because it's a human move I want to play, get my pieces out. Here comes bishop d8. The threat of bishop e7 forces the move knight to g8. And now the move queen g5 comes in anyway. f6, queen g6. There's just no way to deal with threats like bishop g7. You trade everything, and I win the bishop and the rook with check. So, too much. Too much, too much. So, in the game, after queen e3, knight g8 was played voluntarily, but here she comes anyway. Queen g5, threatening bishop d8. Again, did I highlight the whole point of the sacrifice with d5 and d6? Do I need to show you again? Come on, I do, because I love it so much. d5 and then d6. All about the dark squares, right? Some people all about the base, but no, not Lila. She is all about that treble, and she is making her way into the dark squares. It's nasty. It's awesome. Here, f6 was forced because of bishop d8, but here comes queen g6. Rook h6, queen f5, king f7, knight g5, check. The knight comes back to f3. Really, you're playing tickle a little bit right now just because there's still no way to eventually deal with the more pieces coming in. Again, we are playing without the queen side if we're black. h3, g4, bishop h8, and here comes the final reinforcement. It's always a pawn with Lila. g5, rook h5. Bishop back to e3. At this point, you can feel that the initiative is just too strong, because if you do stock of the position, it's basically queen, knight, and bishop versus rook, knight, and bishop with a down king. So I'm not spending as much time trying to prove that ideas like b6 and a5 should have been played, because every one of these moves on the king side was with a tempo. And Stockfish does eventually play b6 here, trying to get developed, but it becomes too little too late. Knight e5 is played with the threat of knight to g6 check. Rook to b8 first, king f1, after b4, no, the threat of knight e5, I'm remembering now, knight g6 check was the other line. You have queen to g6 on the agenda, hitting the rook and the mate. So, after king f1, b4, the queen does go in. You could have played queen g6 the move before, but it doesn't matter. Here she comes, F takes e5, queen takes h5, winning back material, but most importantly, not giving up on the initiative, right? When you start to collect your material after developing the attack, you don't want to give up. You don't want to take material if it means your options are becoming less. She's still outplaying and still making tempi with every move, gaining tempi, making threats. And, okay, in this particular position, there's nowhere else for black to go. The bishop is hanging here. The threat of moving the bishop allows g6, and the queen slides back to f5 into f7. And if something like bishop g7, g6 with queen g5, blocking on f6 doesn't stop anything because the bishop is coming to g5 and everything is falling anyway. So there's really nothing that black can do. Queen takes h8. Now the material is being grabbed. Bishop g2, the king moves. Here comes g6, followed by queen takes h3. Queen h8 wins the rook. By the way, if you didn't do that, d7 was falling. The bishop is coming to g5, and we have mate on the 7th rank. So the point is, how else do you guard d7, right? If rook d8, bishop g5 anyway. If bishop to e8, the queen comes into f5 here, and the mating net is on. So knight f6 was played to give up the rook, and at this point, the game is basically over. I am going to quickly go through it just to show our, you know, TM Leela Trolls the endgame. But as far as the majority of the educational moments of the video are concerned, you've seen it. This has been an absolutely crazy game, a brilliant sacrifice out of the opening. Up a queen here now for just one minor piece. The rest is a matter of Leela technique, which can be rather sloppy, and as many people said on Twitter and made fun of it. But again, just absolutely mind-blowing. I want to show it here because I know that some of you guys just really care about the critical moments, but there's just nothing else to do. There's just too many threats. Again, as I said, moving the bishop, here comes this queen with check. E5 can fall with check. The mating net on the dark squares is real. There's just too much. Wow. So the rook falls, and here she goes. She does her endgame thing. So, even F4, like, what's going on, Leela? Like, just, can you just stop playing with your food? Like, you just give up pawns unnecessarily, make random queen moves unnecessarily. The thing to do was to have the queen and bishop coordinate and shove the h-pawn up the board and end the game quickly. But she's not into that. And again, it's something about the algorithm, I'm always told. It's an open source thing where, like, she calculates things not like chess computers do traditionally with the math. It's all about the probability. And the probabilities aren't necessarily getting worse by playing these moves because they've already calculated that it's a win. So it almost becomes a random roll of the dice which probability they choose. And again, I'm not a scientist. I just play one on YouTube. I don't know if I'm summarizing that exactly right, but there's been a lot of people that have commented about it. Fulcourt, who is one of the top Leela engines, I spent some time with him at the MIT Sports Analytics Conference last year. He kind of said that it's about the probabilities. There's no reason to give up the queen for the knight, and you don't need to, but if the probabilities don't make it worse, apparently it kind of becomes random in terms of the choices it makes. Like, why even give up h5? Anyway, the point is, she does eventually do the job and deliver the goods, and we have just an absolutely fantastic game. I hope you watch this whole video. If you have, leave a comment that proves the last word I said in the video, which you're going to find out what that is in a second. But give us a like, give us a subscribe, give us a share. I really enjoyed analyzing this game. I did so deeply. I wanted to share as much of the analysis as I could with all of you. And thanks for watching it. The last word of the video is peaches.